Hello and welcome to News and Views. I'm John Banfill. Our guest this week is Senator Carl Marcellino. Senator Marcellino, thank you very much for being here.
It's my pleasure, John.
I'd like to start off our new program, discussing our first year program of the year, discussing some changes that are fundamental in our community. And I was wondering if you would discuss some of the changes that occurred in the 5th Senate District, which you represent, as a result of reapportionment, a process our state goes through every 10 years to adjust for population shifts. I was wondering if you could tell us some of the new areas you're representing and how you feel about the new district.
Well, as you know, for 10 years we ran with certain district lines, and people kind of get used to you. Your face, they see a lot. They see your presence when you're in the district. And then all of a sudden, after 10 years, somebody does an analysis and says people moved, or new people came in, or things have changed a little bit, and now we have to reapportion. And by law, that's the way government and in our democracy works, to make sure that we all represent an equal number of individuals, that all the ethnicities, religious groups, racial groups, you name it, are correctly impacted. Nobody is cut out. Nobody is isolated. There was a period of time when some of this redistricting could have been used to isolate certain groups or eliminate certain groups from a district or to weaken their voting representation. But the public should be aware that in recent years, and I'm talking decades now because recent years it only happens once every 10 years, but court cases have been taken into consideration which require us, before the lines can be implemented, the new lines that we are under can be implemented, the courts have to approve the new lines to make sure they meet the Voting Rights Act. In other words, one person, one vote, so that we're not, as I said before, isolating a pocket of people so that you would diminish their voting power, or cutting a community up into little pieces so that you would diminish its voting power or its impact on a district. That sort of thing is frowned upon, and quite frankly, is illegal and shouldn't be done. And to the best of everybody's ability, it's no longer permitted, no longer done during the redistricting, because again, it's wrong, and the court simply would throw the lines out. There is a lawsuit, I think, going on right now that is debating the efficacy of the changes that were made in the district lines, all statewide, that is still under consideration, and will probably be dealt with sometime in the future. They just keep on going on this situation. In the meantime, we picked up some new areas in Nassau County. Of course, the district, as you can see by this map, is a bi-county district. It's approximately 50-50, about 51-49, 51 Nassau County, 49% in Suffolk County. The districts to the south, as you can see, we once went into Farmingdale and Bethpage. We no longer do. We once had most of Hicksville. We no longer do. We had very little of Plainview. We now have almost all of Plainview in the Nassau County side, and very little of Hicksville. I think I have like 5 or 6 EDs left in the Hicksville region. I don't believe I have any EDs left in Bethpage. If I do, it's maybe 1 or 2. We moved in Suffolk County south more than any place else. We went below the expressways into more of Melville, more of Half Hollow Hills and Dix Hills. That we picked up. So where I only had a small piece of the Half Hollow Hill School District, none of the buildings were within my district. I now have a good portion of Half Hollow Hills. I share it with Senator Flanagan, and we now have pretty much the same amount of the area, and I have 1 or 2 of the buildings within my Senate district. And you see that line where there's like an encroachment, the dark area in the Suffolk County region. That went over to Senator Hannon's district. We picked up more of the northward along the Smithtown border. That's the most eastern point, is the Smithtown border. We picked up a significant portion of the east Northport region, and as I said, below the expressways into Half Hollow Hills, and more of Melville, and a little bit more of the Comac area than we used to have. So where I used to represent 14 different school districts, I think it's now something like 16 and fractions of other school districts. So we the district still is very complicated. It still is Republican, Democrat, a what would be considered a fair fight district, probably slightly more Democrat registered than Republican, maybe a few thousand on that basis. And as far as the ethnicities, everybody's there. As far as the religious groups, everybody's there. You name it, it's in that district. And as far as wealth factors, we go from the least haves to the some of the most haves that you could find anywhere. So it's a very diverse district, still interesting and exciting to represent. Lots of challenges that exist because, again, with a district as different as this district, where you have extreme wealth on multi-acre zoning down to some very compressed areas with high density populations and some issues of crime and other things come into play. So we have a lot to deal with.
I know that you've while reapportionment has been one challenge, real life has been going on throughout the end of the last year, and unfortunately, our area is still recovering from the impact of Hurricane Sandy. Mm-hmm. I know that you were leading in the forefront of making sure that when trying to spearhead recovery efforts and making sure that people were getting the help they needed immediately after the storm. But there's a lot going on. There was a lot that needs to be done. Can you give us an update on some of the things that are going on for the recovery?
Well, first, there's the question as to whether or not it in fact was a hurricane. For insurance purposes, that makes a lot of difference. If it was a hurricane when it struck the coast, that means there are certain insurance policies that come into place. There are certain deductibles called hurricane deductibles that come into place. These are very high, so that the insurance company has less liability than the homeowner. If it was a tropical storm, which according to NOAA, the North American, I don't know what the AAA is, a administration, it would have been not the hurricane deductibles. You would have had normal deductibles. That means there would be more insurance liability, and the homeowners would have more protection and more the expectation of more revenue coming from their insurance companies, better coverage, and so forth. Sandy was a very difficult storm in that it was widespread, covered a huge area of the Northeast, went as far south as the Carolinas, and as far north as Maine in its impacts. In fact, it actually ended up in the Canadian provinces in some areas. So it covered a huge, huge area. It was also extremely slow moving. It hung around for quite a while. And that meant those winds, which were, if you're a Category 1 storm, your winds are between 65 and maybe 90 miles an hour. Now, somebody was a Category 1, well, that's nothing. You know, Category 4 is a big one. Category 5, Andrew was a Category 5, I believe. Gloria was a Category 4 way back when. Those are big storms. Well, you stand outside in a 75 mile an hour windstorm, and you'll be blown right down the street without even a heartache. Those winds are powerful. They'll knock anything down. So we saw a huge amount of tree damage. Power lines came down because the trees came down, especially on the north shore of Long Island and the northern versions of most of the areas that it struck. When the trees come down, it takes power lines with them, hits the homes. They hit homes. They do tremendous, tremendous damage. I saw huge trees with 4-foot trunks just literally crushing homes. Leaning on top of homes. Lots of cars got blown away, lots of cars got destroyed, things like that. On the south shore, there was a bigger difference. You don't have the same kind of foliage that we have on the north shore, but you also don't have the height. You're not above sea level the way we are on the north shore. You are at sea level, which means you're subject to flooding. And those areas that were subject to flooding, the Rockaways, Breezy Point, Staten Island, Freeport, the Lindenhurst, the Massapequas, Freeport and Island Park, regions like that, were just devastated. Long Beach, just devastated. In Long Beach, you have the ocean on one side, the bay, Reynolds Channel on the other side. The bay and the ocean met right in the middle, and that's where the people were. I was in Freeport. If anybody knows some of the geography of Nassau County, Freeport, where the old Nautical Mile used to be, with Guy Lombardo along Guy Lombardo Boulevard, where anybody who was anybody, famous people, very wealthy people, all lived down there. They had their boats down there. This was a place to be, a destination point, many years ago. And along that boulevard was called the Nautical Mile, completely wiped out. Not a store, not a restaurant, and this is an economic engine for that region of the county, and specifically for the village of Freeport. Nothing is left in that region, and they had been elevated to a certain extent as a result of Irene the previous year. So there was some adjustments made to work on that. I was standing with the mayor of Freeport on Merrick Road, which is a fair distance away from the water. It was 6 feet underwater at that point. This is a commercial area now. We're not talking about, you know, a beachfront. This is major distance, maybe a mile or two from the ocean, 6 feet underwater on Merrick Road. The water went even further than Merrick, further north up to Sunrise Highway, which is a considerable distance, another half mile at least, beyond north of Merrick Road. So for those who live down there, will understand what I'm saying. The height of the water and the movement of the water and the speed of the movement of the water was what caught an awful lot of people by surprise. And those people who, especially in Long Beach, who decided, we're not leaving. We've heard this before. You know, the county executive, Ed Mangano, in his wisdom, ordered an emergency evacuation, said, get out. This is going to be a problem. So did Christie in New Jersey. Everybody said, get out. A lot of people didn't go. They didn't trust the weather service because they've heard before, you know, we've heard this cry before, and nothing really happened, and it, you know, so we moved, and this is just a big waste of time. I'm going to ride it out. You know, I'm here. I've done this before. I've ridden through storms. And when I was a kid, I was in Far Rockaway, where my parents owned a bungalow on the beach, and we rode out storms, hurricanes, several times there, and nothing ever happened of any real significance. We went right through them, and the eye came right over us, no problem. We were playing in the streets within hours. Well, this time, this was for real. And people were sitting in their streets, and all of a sudden they saw water coming down the street. And then all of a sudden it was a few inches, then it was a few feet, then the house was, the first level of the house was inundated, and they were huddling in their second floor, and then they were huddling in their attics, and in some cases they had to climb onto the roofs to get away from it, if they could. Getting people in to rescue them, impossible, because in the middle of a storm you just can't do it. Some first responders who, by the way, deserve yeoman's credit, fire departments, the police department, anyone who was in emergency services, who was out there in that storm trying to help people, deserves the highest recognition we can give them, and our highest and most heartfelt thanks, because those people really put it on the line for their neighbors and their communities, and risking, in many cases, their own lives in doing it. Some lost their lives as a result of this. In Florida, there's a law that says if the wind is over 50 miles an hour, nobody goes out. If you're stuck out there and you're foolish enough to be in that storm and you didn't leave when you were told, you're going to wait it out. You're on your own. They're not sending it. Their attitude is, we are not risking people's lives any more than we have to, because we're going to have to send them out as soon as the storm is over. Then they'll come and get you. But as long as the storm is blown and the winds are over 50, you're on your own. Take care of yourself. You shouldn't have been there in the first place. That is their attitude. And these are people who deal with hurricanes on a routine basis, or tropical storms on a routine basis. So this kind of thing we have to start looking at as far as taking care of the first responders, so we don't have a problem down there. But the storm was devastating. The length of the storm existing over our area was designating. My house, we lost power for 2 weeks. Others were briefer, others were longer. But you know, my complaint to the lighting company, the power company, LIPA, was that we were in the winter, and it was only going to get colder. And you better get things done quickly. And the communication had to be done as rapidly as possible, because it was dangerous.
Well, Senator Marcellino, I'd like to have you back, actually, on a future show to discuss what is happening as far as the rebuilding of after this horrible storm. So I'd like to, and that we can bring our viewers up to speed on what's going on that front. I want to thank you very much for being here.
My pleasure.
We'll see you soon.